right? Okay, uyindoda, man. And okay, for example, now when I go back home, my grandma will say, okay, uyindoda, da 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 da. But for me to actually go along with that, I have to suppress the sexuality. So I can't, so I have to perform heteronormativity or go, heterosexuality or go. And I want to find out, what does that mean for someone in that masculinity spirit? If you have to suppress your sexuality for you, what does it mean? Doesn't it again put you at the dirty bottom of the entire spectrum?
Thank you for that one.
Thank you.
for having taken time to read the work and commented on it. I'm going to try to put everything together and instead of singling out practical questions. If I don't, please feel free to come to me afterwards. I want to start with the concept of masculine hierarchies that you basically mentioned there. I think it's very important that we all write, we are all positioned as authors. We don't write from a vacuum, right? We write from a particular social position. And I'm very sort of excited to hear that there are other voices, that are coming from various directions. Because the whole idea for me of writing this paper was to really open up the debate. And each person can take up the idea of what it means to be a man based on the social position that they occupy. That's what we need to write, to do when we feel right about the order. It's not just gay men who need to know. They are closer speaking men who are, for example, umfundis, right? How do we theorize the position of a person called umfundis who does not perform tradition, who does not engage in the things that are supposed to make him a real? Is that person a real man or not? Is that person still recognized as indoda or not? So, and I think it comes back to the issue that Thoko, I think someone else raised, the issue of the critique that I'm reducing Ubudoda to Ulalu, meaning to what Wine and Paul is the mark, right? The critique that I'm reducing Ulalu to the mark, and that I'm saying that Ulalu is just about acquiring the mark and everything else is not very important. In fact, in the paper, I do say that the process of going through circumcision is the beginning, and I do acknowledge that one still needs to work on the body. That the body is not just there sitting for you to recover and then you become a man. One is recognized as a real man because it's the work that you do on the body in order to pass as a man. So that those who don't actually go through the process successfully can be labeled as not mature because they've not done the required work. And I also do reflect on the fact that actually the outcome of Ulanogo is not certain. Things go wrong. And I do ask in one of the settings that then what happens then when things go wrong? What happens when their penis changed or whatever? Does that person still remain a man? What makes him a man in that context? So if you read the paper closely, you realize that I'm not actually making decisive statements. I'm opening up the debate. I'm raising a lot of questions. I'm not answering all the questions. Instead, I'm raising more and more to kind of address the issue that you are talking about, Sanele. I do say that the process does fail. And what and I'm supposed to wasn't talks about this as well as well. Actually the process does fail. The case that you're describing is somebody who actually healed but sort of underwent some problems. So I'm not reducing it to the mask. I also wanna talk about the issue of the concepts, right? And this is what I'm trying to bring out. But when you read some of these writings in the logo, you come across this concept that when men come out of the initiation school, they must be sequent. That's not true. And it's not for me to tell you what this is. But that concept is not true. That concept is not sequent, right? So the idea of saying we must really use this concept is really because sometimes they tend to be written wrong. Sometimes the account of what it means to be a man written by outsiders tend to be inaccurate. And that article by Ndozi is wrong in saying that men speak secret outside. Another issue that I kind of want to talk about is the issue that was mentioned, the issue of downgrading of men who don't perform particular many acts. I don't agree that there's any such thing as downgrading of indoda. If you're going to go indoda, if you come indoda, you remain indoda. If you are downgraded, what do you become? You don't become Inkwenkwe. Because Inkwenkwe has not gone through circumcision. Inkwenkwe is defined by a particular location, by a particular physical mark. So the idea is that if we don't perform particular acts, we become downgraded. I don't agree with that. Okay. So what am I doing in my paper is that
Yes, you can say to a particular man, I hope you will respect his way. But it does not necessarily mean his way. Respect his way, yes, but it's not. The fact that you say, hope, respect his way, it means you are recognizing that he is a man. He is indolent. So when I discuss, you know, the idea of this, I'm saying, let us theorize ubuni bobudoda. What is this thing called? Not the performance, because that's what the Western theorists are saying. They're saying a man is what you do. And I'm saying, no, it's not entirely true. So the idea that you can be downgraded and become something else, give me a name for that downgrade. If that downgrade is true. Because you will not be called equal. You never become equal like you once you cross over that being. I also want to address the issue of the assumption of heterosexuality that happens in relation to the idea that once you come out of that group, you kind of have to suppress the idea of who you are. Anyway, arguing that, are you not then downgraded at the lower level? You see that, right? Are you not then downgraded at the lower level if you are not allowed to practice if you are required to suppress your men, you're saying that, right? You are saying that if you undergo Ulwalugo and you gain, right? And you go back home, you are not allowed to show who you are yourself. You're supposed to suppress who you are. And we're saying that that ultimately means you are downgrade. You are at a lower level of masculinity.
Because they say you're not a man.
But then, if you're at a low level of masculinity, where do you fit in relation to Inkwenkwe? Are you lower than Inkwenkwe? Or are you a little bit above Inkwenkwe?
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So, if you said you are downgraded to down low, it means that you're basically invoking the Gregory Herrick kind of argument that says, it's your sexuality that base your okay. You know, and that argument is not entirely, because if you want, you can choose to dress differently and go to a kidding, and no one is going to change your clothes.
Why should you say that?
So I'm saying, if you want to challenge that downgrading, you can challenge it. But people will never challenge it. People will never decide to go to the next one and try to be a man. You can do it.
No, but what happened? We are talking about seeking for more up, or ungabo seeking for more, and then like those microaggressions. Those microaggressions that
come in. What happens is that you need to separate the practice. And I actually use the Western views. Look, in Western theories, masculinity is what you do. And we ask a totally different story. It's not just your practices that make you a man, it's more than that. And this idea of saying that I'm reducing it to a man. Indeed, see, in Western theories, you can define masculinity, I mean, the body. The idea of the body is that, yes, and I think this is what Sanele was saying, that ultimately I am reproducing the very theories that I have to take. I disagree with. Because the theories of masculinity, as I explained earlier, argue that to be a man, you must perform particular acts. It's about what you do that makes you a man. And the body does not really. Of course, you perform things with your body. But the problem with social construction theory is that it treats the body as having no essence. It's just the body. And you can do whatever you want to do. A body of a circumcised person is a culturally inscripted body. It's a spiritually inscripted body. And that's why you go through now and everything else is to constitute you spiritually. So when you enact that body, it's not just a thing floating in the air. That body is cultural. It's not the same as the body of a person in Western society who can decide at any given point to announce himself as a man. The strategy for domination of women and humiliating out men. Yet the problem is also okay. So that's really the core of what I'm saying. The core of what I'm trying to say. If we theorize masculinity properly, it will open up avenues for our forms of intervention and to also address the problem of the internal economy. Because no one will be able to change it.
Well, the question that I
think is
So the first question is about love and also assigned to Daba, which is the Daba in the Xhosa idioms, being, conceptualization of safety, and so on and so forth. So my starting point is that what happens socially, what becomes a reality socio-politically is also becoming culturally entrenched. So when there's homophobia socially, and that homophobia also manifests itself within the cultural practices. So even when the people go to the mountains, the mountains not going to be devoid of what is going on, socially. So that's what is happening. So you have that tension. You have that tension. Whereas conceptually, the mountain is supposed to be a place where there's safety and protection. But what's happening then? Happening socially then is culturally entrenched. So that's my opinion. The question, second question about the lessons in part the endurance, about endurance and experience and patience. I highlighted that it was one of the aspects that is associated with the time. So over certain spaces in time, in the reconstruction of the by the time, for example, in the 1800s, people stayed there for like 6 months to a year, and that had a cultural significance that is embedded in the culture. But over time, obviously, this has changed. Living in an industrial world, post-colonial, post-apartheid world, and there's other things that are going on in society, and the time is limited. People stay there, about to stay there for about 3 to 4 weeks. So then it becomes different. But the essence of timing, it was something to do with the lessons of integration, being secluded from the community for a long time. And that was one aspect, but not an entire aspect that makes one element. And I alluded to this point that other things is the connection between the culture and the land and other things that are synthetic in the space that. I think those are the two questions.
Circumcision the traditional way, and he was the wayward one. And then the other one, he had gone through the hospital, but he was the most responsible character in his book. Now, his resource in this book, he said that Ndiyindoda ngezenzo, the man's actions determine his manhood within his society. Now, what I want to ask, because when I hear you, to me, it sounds similar to what Pitini said. I would like to ask whether, are we saying now the initiation rite of passage is becoming more and more irrelevant if ubudoda has nothing to do with your actual physicality, but it has everything to do with your intellectual and intellectual capacity and your actions. And also, to kind of highlight what my sister Ndomi was talking about, the difference in terms of the standard or where one is placed when you are coming from the hospital and when you are coming from the mountain. So are we saying now, because of the actions, there should be no difference between a man who comes from the bush and a man who comes from the hospital? In essence, if we are saying yes to that, are we saying that Ulwaluko is becoming irrelevant, or is it irrelevant in terms of determining what a man is in society?
Is there a question at the back? Is there a question or comment at the back?
I've got a question mainly for Thoko, actually. My question is with think the reason why a lot of people have contention with what you were saying, Prof, is because, like, I think at the beginning the conversation wasn't structured properly. I think there are two questions here. There is what is masculinity versus what masculinity ought to be, right? Those are two different things. I think what you were talking about is like characterizing what is. And you were like, and so you weren't contending what is versus what ought to be. You were contending Western frameworks of defining masculinity versus like indigenous frameworks of defining masculinity. So it was never a contestation of definitions, it was a contestation of the frameworks in which those definitions are created, right? I have a problem with that kind of conversation because, one, I still like need a definition, right? Two, the problem with having a definition anyway, which is why I think that conversation is potentially dangerous and potentially also trans-exclusive, is because of the fact that necessarily when you put a definition to it, you're going to leave someone else out, right? So if you're saying that A is this, you're saying that A is not that. That's my first thing. Secondly, like, this conversation touches home very, 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 on a very, very personal level. One, when I came out to my parents as gay, literally what my mother then did was to call my boyfriend at the time and to say, come collect your wife, right? So when you talk about the fact that sexuality doesn't necessarily negate manhood, you're wrong, right? Because I like have lived that. I have been called something, not just by my mother, by my father, by other relatives, by people, like in general, that things that necessarily negate my manhood, assuming of course that my manhood is somehow important. Then number three. So when I was 3 years old, right, I had penile development problems, right, and necessarily what had to happen is that I had to cut my foreskin off, so I'm medically circumcised, which means that I can't occupy certain spaces, precisely because I'm medically circumcised, right? That was a conscious decision on my father's part, one that I have now personally come to regret because it means that like now there are spaces that I not only can't navigate, but am like violated in not only emotionally, but also physically, right? Then there's another thing. We can talk about what Xhosa masculinity means among Xhosa people, right? Sure, cool. But it then becomes very tense when we talk about the fact that a lot of Xhosa men secretly don't like the fact that Jacob Zuma is president because he hasn't been circumcised. So these are the kinds of chats that we're going to be having. Also when we talk about men being men through actions, like what are those actions and why is it necessarily that when, for example, like I've got it clear on, like that's necessarily.
And my question is with regards to reimagining the spaces where we are going to teach these new theories of masculinity and identifying them. And my question is to what do we imagine that space to be, and how would we then use that language in that particular space? Because the understanding of ubudoda is also very exclusionary in the sense that women are not allowed in that space. Yes. As the lady up there said, she didn't know those words because she was not allowed to know those words in the first place. Yes. So when we reimagine those places, now I amagama, I notice siwa kama, siwa sebenzi sukuti, now abafazi bazivuba hayi indoda iyenziwa so because I can't imagine me writing that particular work because I am a black Xhosa woman, I am not allowed in that space.
And the upper tenor of the indoor, they're on course. That's a sexual experience for someone else that happens in everyday. We are wondering, so Ngati Munanga, we are the Mogabo, in our young Kambu, Rura, any platform, Uti, being a bit too charming, so far as being a Tundu, Yanyam, Wombu's work. Sitsali, I booze in jail because I bam is queen, Kandine. Is a and then the Moki
Gonzaganese. First of all, that question up there, that said Jokbala, basically alluding to that woman should be excluded into discussion about your daughter, or speak about it. First of all, who gives birth to the mother to tell about it? So how could you exclude a person who gave birth to when that would not be the one to go through this process? Number two, we're talking about the street to talk. It must be referred to your practice associated with being a man. Meaning that being a man is to going to become indoda. So how do you, what the question he asked about it, how do you, where do you put the indoda who has embodied indoda as a pretense in order to fit the norm? Where would you put indoda then where would the back of all in act as well, the pretense in order to fit the norm? So in the hierarchy as well, then your mood and indoda being at the bottom and being at the top and only being at the bottom, where do you put the norm in that? And then lastly, I think in order for us to get like a holistic understanding of this topic, I think we need to go back then to defining what is indoda and what's in Israel, because I would like to know from a general domain, what is the from why you're first? I'm not sure.
Which is why I'm not nagging at. Then I don't know what I want to talk about. He knows I can do it. You have to read it out.
Is it whatever?
So we need to basically look at this. And find a lot of it from people who are not closer speaking, who are writing about this thing, you know, such as this guy called Penter, who are writing about the effect of internet. And you can see that there's actually a lot there. What is going on? But again, nage ithetha le ndlela ikhula ngayo ngenda ngifikele ngayo ukuthi akazange mina abantu badinga labe like by school. And I think more than 50 years ago. And azange ngibona abantu.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. I'm going to go to the hospital.